Simon & Schuster Audio presents Light of the World, a Dave Robicheaux novel by James Lee Burke. Read by Will Patton.
I was never good at solving mysteries. I don't mean the kind cops solve or the ones you read about in novels or watch on television or on a movie screen. I'm not talking about the mystery of creation either, or the unseen presences that reside perhaps just the other side of the physical world. I'm talking about evil. Without capitalization, but evil all the same. The kind whose origin sociologists and psychiatrists have trouble explaining. Hitler, Nero, Ted Bundy, the bitch of Buchenwald, their deeds are not ours. But if these individuals are not like us, if they do not descend from the same gene pool and have the same DNA, then who were they and what turned them into monsters? When I was in plain clothes at the NOPD, I used to deal with problems such as these in a saloon on Magazine Street, not far from the old Irish Channel. With its brass-railed bar and felt-covered bourrée tables and wood-bladed fans, it became my secular church where the Louisiana of my youth, the green-gold, mossy, oak-shaded world of Bayou Teche, was only one drink away. I had come to feel loathing and disgust with the mythology that characterized the era in which I lived. I didn't serve in Southeast Asia. I survived and watched innocent people and better men than I die in large numbers while I was spared by hand outside myself. My real problem wasn't the militarization of my country or any of the other problems I've mentioned. The real problem went back to a mystery that had beset me since the destruction of my natal home and family. My father, Big Aldous, was on the monkey board of an offshore drilling well when the drill bit punched into an early pay sand and a spark jumped off the wellhead, and a mushroom of flaming oil and natural gas rose through the rigging like an inferno ballooning from the bottom of an elevator shaft. My mother, Alafair May Guillory, was seduced and blackmailed by a gambler and pimp named Mac, whom I hated more than any human being I ever knew, not because he turned her into a barroom whore, but because of the Asian men I killed in his stead. I stayed 90 proof for many years and got a bachelor's degree in self-immolation and a doctorate in chemically induced psychosis. When I finally entered sobriety, I thought the veil might be lifted and I would find answers to all the Byzantine riddles that had confounded me. That was not to be the case. Instead, a man who was one of the most wicked creatures on earth made his way into our lives. This is a tale that maybe I shouldn't share, but it's not one I want to keep inside me either. My adopted daughter, Alafair Robicheaux, jogged up a logging road that wound through ponderosa pine and Douglas fir and cedar trees atop a ridge overlooking a two-lane highway and a swollen creek far below. Alafair was listening to a song on her iPod when she felt a stinging sensation on her left ear. Without stopping, she swatted at her hair and pressed her hand against her ear and then looked at it. There was a bright smear of blood on her palm. Above, she saw two ravens glide into the boughs of a ponderosa and begin cawing at the sky. She touched her ear again, but the cut she believed the raven had inflicted was no longer bleeding and felt like little more than a scratch. That was when she saw the aluminum shaft of a feathered arrow embedded 3 inches deep in a cedar snag that had been scorched and hardened in a fire. She took off her earbuds and listened. "Is there a bow hunter out there?" Alafair shouted. "If you made a mistake and you're sorry, just come out and apologize," she yelled. She fitted both hands on the shaft of the arrow and jerked it from the cedar trunk. The arrowhead was made of steel and was bright and slick with a thin sheen of oil and flanged and wavy on the edges, which had been honed as sharp as a razor. She made her way back down the ridge almost to the bottom, then walked out on a rocky point that formed a V and jutted into space and was devoid of trees and second growth. Below, she saw a broad-shouldered man with a narrow waist, wearing wranglers and a white straw hat and a bandana tied around his neck. He was latching the door on a camper shell inserted in the bed of his pickup truck. "Hey, buddy," Alafair said. "I want a word with you."
"Why, howdy doody," he said, an idiot's grin painted on his mouth. "Where'd a cute little heifer like you come from?"
"Does this arrow belong to you?" she asked.
"I'll take it if you don't want it."
"Did you shoot this fucking arrow at me or not?"
"I can't hear very good in the wind. What was that word you used?"
He cupped one hand to his ear.
"Want to come down here and talk?"
"Somebody almost killed me with this arrow."
"There's a truck stop next to the casino. I'll buy you a Coca-Cola. They got showers there if you want one."
"Was that a bow you were putting in your camper? You owe me an answer."
"My name is Mr. Wyatt Dixon of Fort Davis, Texas. I'm a bullfighter and a handler of rough stock and a born-again Christian. What do you think of them apples? Come on down, girl. I ain't gonna bite."
He removed his hat and drew a pocket comb through his silky red hair, tilting up his chin.
"I'm a student of accents. You're from somewhere down south. See you down the track, sweet thing."
He led a semi carrying a huge piece of oil machinery past and got in his truck and drove away. In the early spring, Alafair and my wife Molly and my old partner from NOPD, Clete Purcell, had returned to western Montana with plans to spend the summer on a ranch owned by a novelist and retired English professor whose name was Albert Hollister. Albert installed Clete in a guest cabin located at the far end of the property and the rest of us on the third floor of the house. From the balcony, we had a wonderful view of the wooded foothills that seemed to topple for miles and miles before they reached the Bitterroot Mountains, white and shining, as bright as glaciers on the peaks and strung with mist at sunrise. The sun had set by the time Alafair returned to the house. She told me of her encounter with Wyatt Dixon. "Did you get his tag?" I asked. "There was mud on it. He said he was going to the casino." We drove in my pickup down the dirt road to the two-lane and turned east and followed the creek into Lolo, a small service town at the gateway to the Bitterroot Mountains. The sky was purple and flecked with snow, the neon lights glowing in front of the truck stop and adjacent casino. "The orange pickup, that's his," she said. I rubbed the film off the rear window of the camper inset in his truck bed and peered inside. I could make out a lumpy duffel bag, a Western saddle, a long barrel lever-action rifle with an elevator sight and a mud-caked truck tire and a jack. I didn't see a bow. I looked through the passenger window with the same result. The inside of the casino was dark and refrigerated and smelled of carpet cleaner and bathroom disinfectant. A man in a white straw cowboy hat was at the bar, drinking from a soda can and eating a sandwich. "My name is Dave Robicheaux," I said. "This is my daughter, Alafair. I'd like to have a word with you. I understand you're a rodeo man."
"What some call a rodeo clown. What we call bullfighters. At one time I shot mustangs for a dog food company down on the border. I don't do that no more."
"Were you hunting about 5 miles up Highway 12?
"No, sir. I was changing the tire on my truck."
"You have any idea who might have shot an arrow at my daughter?"
"No, but I'm getting mighty tired of hearing about it."
"Call 911, I said to Alafair. People were staring at us, although he took no notice of them. I said, You called my daughter girl and sweet thing. You also made a veiled threat about seeing her down the track. Don't ever come near us again, Mr. Dixon. He glanced through the front window at a sheriff's cruiser pulling into the parking lot.
That 911 deputy ain't gonna find nothing in my truck, 'cause there ain't nothing to find, he said.
Before you get your nose too high in the air, Mr. Robicheaux, your daughter asked me if that fucking arrow was mine. She talked to me like I...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.